Tonight, he came up with Obama's America, and now he has Hillary's America. For the next hour, I will be with Dinesh D'Souza. So get ready, because it's all unfiltered. Hello, I'm Dennis Michael Lynch, and I thank you for joining me this evening. There will be no DML report tonight because I have Dinesh D'Souza here with me for the next hour. We are going to be talking about his new film called Hillary's America. We all know how successful Obama's America was. Dinesh D'Souza tonight is going to tell us about what we are in for if Hillary Clinton is elected president. That being said, Dinesh, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
I want to do this a little backward. I want to talk about Obama's America. And the reason being is because I think it's critically important for people to realize how much you are in the know. I just watched, by chance, your film again, Obama's America, not more than a couple weeks ago. And watching it for the second time, it's astonishing how right your predictions have come out to be.
For a long time, I sat between the two graves and wept. The pain I felt was my father's pain. My questions were my brother's questions. Their struggle, my birthright.
Obama has a dream from his father, that the sins of colonialism be set right and America be downsized.
It's been a long time coming, but tonight, because of what we did on this day, in this election, at this defining moment, change has come to America.
America has a dream from our founding fathers that together we must perfect liberty and America must grow so liberty grows. Which dream will we carry into 2016?
So when you look back at what you saw in 2012 when you made that film, and you look today at the way America is, of all the predictions you made, which ones are most troubling to you that have come true?
Well, in that movie, we tried to get to the soul of Obama, to kind of get to how he thinks about the world. And I identified his ideology as anti-colonial, as something derived from his father. The notion that America is a force for oppression in the world. This is what Obama believes. And as consequently, he views his job as one of shrinking America's power and influence. Now, out of that came several predictions. One was that Obama would continue to be a big spender, in a sense eroding our national treasure, doubling the national debt. That has happened. Number two, Obama would try to colonize industries of the private sector, bring them under the rod of government control. We've seen that happen in healthcare, in finance, with banks, insurance companies. Obama will undermine our allies and help our enemies. This is a wild prediction because you elect a president to protect America's interests. But you can just look clinically around the world. Our allies, Mubarak in Egypt, he's gone. Gaddafi wasn't an ally, but he was working with us since the Iraq war. He's gone. Our enemies, Assad in Syria, he's fully in power. The mullahs in Iran, they're stronger than ever. So it is simply empirically verifiable that Obama has actually achieved this result. ISIS did not really exist. Obama and Hillary come in, now we have ISIS. And we also said that the Muslims will begin to start creating this transnational, I called it the United States of Islam.
Yeah.
And if you look at ISIS, the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, it's very clear that they are not only consolidating, but bringing the battle to us here. So I think Obama, in a way, this demented man can be proud of his legacy. He said he would transform America, and he has. And he has transformed it in the direction that we said he would. So I feel very, I don't know if I'm proud to be vindicated because these are bad things to happen to America. I would rather have been proven wrong.
Right.
But I'm glad to see I made a film that called Obama right.
Well, one of the things that you said in the film, which I talk about here on the show all the time, is the fact that although he never met his father, he's influenced by his father, right? So when you describe, when you take a look at that, do you see any sort of person in Hillary's life that has that same sort of influence?
In Hillary's life, I think it would have to be Alinsky. Now, an interesting thing about Alinsky is that conservatives tend to focus on the radical Alinsky. Alinsky wrote a book, Rules for Radicals. He's got all these recipes and so on for political activism. And that's one side of Alinsky, and it's a legitimate side. Ben Carson was alluding to that side when he talked about Alinsky dedicating his book to Lucifer. But in the movie, the new movie, Hillary's America, we focus on another side of Alinsky, which Alinsky himself talked about in the last year of his life. Alinsky talked about the fact that he was basically a thief and a gangster, kind of a mafia guy. Alinsky was a petty thief on the streets of Chicago. Then he got to the University of Chicago and he developed a kind of a, almost call it a thievery scheme, to eat free in the cafeteria. Now, you know, I can see some poor slum kid figuring out a way to eat free, but Alinsky would have seminars on the topic. He'd put up signs, come and learn the Alinsky method for eating free without paying. And so you can almost see the beginning of community organizing occurring right there. This guy Alinsky is organizing ways to rip off the university. Later he gets in with the Al Capone gang. He admires their extortionist rackets. He doesn't like the fact that gangsters sometimes get knocked off. So he thinks, I'll take these ideas to politics. In politics, I can pull off extortion a la Jesse Jackson, but I won't get knocked off. And it's kind of amazing to think that Obama and Hillary are both influenced by this guy, who's obviously a thief and a bit of a mobster.
When you, let's go back to Obama for a second. When you watch him absolutely, completely ignore for so long the rule of law, and then you see now what's going on with the cops and how it is that Black Lives Matter is not only emerging, but all, he fuels them. What inside him is driving that? Because to the rest of us, we look at this and say, why are you supporting these people? And he continues to do so.
Now, Obama is different than Hillary, I believe, even though they have Alinsky in common. And Alinsky was sort of a mentor to both. Now, Obama didn't know Alinsky personally, but he studied with the Alinskyites. Hillary knew Alinsky in person. But the difference between Obama and Hillary is that Obama is fueled, I think, ultimately by ideological hatred. For Obama, he looks at America and he goes, you know, how dare they? Not how dare we, but how dare they? Meaning, here's America, they have 5% of the world's population, but Americans enjoy 20% of the world's resources. America has 5% of the world's oil, but we use 25% of the world's oil. So he's thinking, this is unjust. These Americans are ripping off the rest of the world. It's my job, the great Obama, to set the ship of the world right side up. And that means diminishing America's power so that the other countries, Brazil, China, Russia, India, can come up. So I think Obama sees this as his, you may say, perverted destiny. Now, with Hillary, it's not about ideology. It's about the Clintons. It's Bonnie and Clyde. It's a racket. And these two have been running this tag team show since the Arkansas days. It's all about them. They're sort of brokers of public policy, which is to say that they figure out how to do public policy and keep 10%. And they do this with domestic policy, they do it with foreign policy. And so Hillary's America, I think, is going to be a more gangsterish place.
Before we get there, because we're going to talk about that in the next segment. If Hillary wins, and we have about a minute, what sort of role, if any, do you think Obama will play in her presidency?
I think Obama, there's the only place for him to go from here is to become, in a sense, what he would see as the conscience of the world. Now, this is all pure grand illusion and posturing. He's actually a very petty man. He's a narcissistic guy. His favorite position is to look in the mirror. He's not the conscience of anything in reality. But he's a lot like his dad. His father had the same warped delusions. His father thought he was a super important guy. The future of Kenya depended on him. Complete nonsense. But Obama's the same. He lives in his own world. And I think he wants to be, if you will, even higher than the President of the United States. You may call him sort of the grand poobah of the universe, looking down on the rest of us and telling us what to do. He'd love to play that role. I think he will actually lapse into largely into irrelevance. But that's what he'd like.
All right, when we come back, we're going to be focusing in on the new movie and Hillary Rodham Clinton. What will Hillary's America look like?
While Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State, the Clintons took hundreds of millions of dollars from foreign entities.
Shame on you! Shame on you!
She looked very menacing. I was really frightened.
I didn't see any reason to keep them. The fact is, we had four dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
It is my judgment.
Dinesh D'Souza was sentenced on Tuesday to spend 8 months in a confinement center.
It all began when the Obama administration tried to shut me up.
You know, gangs are all about stealing, man.
What did I learn?
All crime is about stealing. The big criminals are still at large.
Didn't see any reason to keep them.
The system doesn't go after them. Because they run the system. It's time to go behind the curtain and discover the soul of the Democratic Party.
Explain what we just saw in that clip.
Well, in that clip, you see me in the confinement center. This is a federal confinement center under the supervision of the Bureau of Prisons. And this was for my heinous offense of giving $20,000 of my own money to a college friend of mine who was running for the U.S. Senate in New York. I shouldn't have done it, but I did it without any corrupt motive, just to help a friend. And there's no one in all of American history who has been prosecuted, let alone locked up, for doing what I did. Typically, a campaign finance law is to prevent corruption. So you're trying to buy office, you're trying to ultimately get some legislation passed, and so the money changes hands for that purpose. Nothing like that was involved here. So I believe I was persecuted, selectively prosecuted by Obama in retaliation for making this movie 2016. And the reason I know that Obama was upset by the movie is he began to rage against me on a website, barackobama.com. And so I think I was stupid in committing this technical violation of the law, which gave them a pretext to go after me.
Dennis Michael Lynch is also a conservative documentary filmmaker, the producer of They Come to America, and he spent time with Dinesh as their careers have crossed. Dennis, it's good to see you, and I know you believe that he may be a victim of political targeting here. Why?
Absolutely. Film is the most powerful medium we have. You have a captive audience for 2 hours. So when you make a film that hits the president between the eyes and could shift an election, you become a target because you're not only a talking, but you're a visual, and you put that together. So I know I've lived through this with immigration reform. I mean, I help impact which way that's going to go by showing films that give you what you need to see. You do that, you become dangerous to the other side. When you're dangerous to the other side, you walk around with a target on your back, and that's what you're seeing.
I tried to turn the lemon into lemonade by learning from this experience and then putting it into this film, the new film, and basically using it to widen my horizons and how I understand politics, not merely as a function of ideas, two groups debating each other, but also as a racket, a kind of criminal racket. And of course, being with the hoodlums and sleeping in bunk beds with them, I learned something about gangs, about criminal rackets, about extortion, how you get money out of people. Excellent preparation for studying the Democratic Party.
Well, let me ask you, if I was going to ask you this later on, but I'll ask you now because you're bringing it up. If, God forbid, she wins, are you afraid that you're going to have to, I mean, I'm sure you haven't done anything else of the sorts, but I mean, are you afraid that she'll try to retaliate against you as well?
You know, I have to watch my back, and I realize that I'm kind of on the front line. I think in some ways that's a safe place to be. Because think about it, if the narrator, author, and creator of Hillary's America were to disappear, who would be the main suspect?
Well, I don't even mean to that end. I just mean to the end of, like, she will just try to make your life miserable.
Yeah, I expect, you know, that is fully in character for the Clintons. Because they operate kind of in the Al Capone mode. They would like to be, I think if they had their way, unlike Obama, their goal is to be the mob boss of America. So if you think about Al Capone, what did Al Capone want in Chicago? He wanted the city to run at his behest and command. He wanted to loot the treasury. Mm-hmm. He wanted to give contracts to his buddies. He wanted his opponents and critics to be moved off stage, snuffed out, pushed away. And he wanted to walk into the Chicago Cubs stadium and have the whole crowd go, Big Al, Big Al, Big Al. This is basically the cult-like ambition of the Clintons. Now, Bill's ambitions are more circumscribed, because I think if Bill has big meals, everyone thinks he's the greatest, he has women lined up the door, he's happy. With Hillary, it's a more tyrannical impulse. She wants to run everything. She wants to control everything. She'd love to run your life and my life. And so she's a scarier character, to my way of thinking, than Bill.
So then, I guess the answer is that you expect that she will give you a hard time if she does get elected president.
I think she will try to, happily. We don't live today in India or Venezuela. Mm-hmm. My wife's from Venezuela. I think if we live in those countries, they're run by gangs. Mm-hmm. And I can't make this kind of a movie over there, because they'll just send gangs to the house to beat you up and break all your furniture and take your big screen TV. We still live in America. We still have fundamental rights. We still have separation of powers, checks and balances. Hopefully we'll maintain an independent judiciary. So there are protections here that I still count on.
Look, you know, when you take a look at the mainstream media, actually, if you even do the numbers, you take Fox News, you take Newsmax, you put us together, we don't even touch a fraction of what ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN, MSNBC, that they all reach. So not the numbers of people who have to see a film like yours or have to hear the message that you give on something like this, we need to get it out there more. So what I want you to do is I want you to explain how this movie, if put in front of an independent, how this movie will influence them. Because I think ultimately, one thing I've always done, it's been very helpful with when I was doing my DVD program, is I would give out extras and I'd say, listen, you gotta put this in front of a Democrat so they understand how bad immigration is. When they see it, they'll think differently. How does the person at home right now who's watching this, who's a conservative, what in that film is it that you say, you gotta say this to your friends and get them to the theater?
The film is very explosive because it challenges the central core basis of the whole Democratic Party. In this way, it's a much more destructive and it's a much more subversive film than Obama's America. Because Obama's America was about one man, and that man was an outsider. And even for 8 years, his relationship with the Democratic Party somewhat tenuous. Hillary comes right out of the progressive movement and right out of the Democratic Party. And the Democratic Party has a moral claim to rule. And that is, we Democrats have always been the party of the little man, the ordinary guy. We have been the party of women's suffrage and fighting for women's rights. We freed the slaves and fought for civil rights. We're the party of blacks. We fought for immigration. We're the party of Latinos. Now, we in the film expose that all of this is a big, fat lie. The Democrats have been the party that has been the deadly enemy of the ordinary guy. They have been the enslavers and segregators of blacks and lynchers of blacks. They have been the party that has blocked immigration and tormented the Hispanics and the Latinos. They fought women's suffrage tooth and nail for 25 years. They lost in Congress, and they fought it in the states where they lost again. So this is the actual history of the Democratic Party. Fast forward to this recent email scandal, and you see how the Democrats privately talk about blacks. When they talk about Hispanics, it's the Taco Bell gang, because they think of Hispanics as serving you in Taco Bell. They insult blacks, they insult homosexuals, they make fun of Bernie Sanders' religion. So they put up a big front out here, and in Philadelphia, all these squid-like cloud of rhetoric, but the reality of the party is somewhat different. So if independents, if blacks, if Latinos saw this movie, the effect would be discombobulating, because it would show that all the stuff that they've been spoon-fed by the media and academia is wrong. And so I would love to figure out a way to get this movie in front of them. It's not easy, because like you say, typically you preach to the converted, and it's important to preach to the converted, But if we could get a way to get it to the outsider, that would be fantastic.
Has ABC, NBC, CBS, any of those major networks had you on yet?
No, those guys are covering for Hillary, and they're absolutely, I mean, just think about it. If it turned out that the Republican Party was fixing its primary election, putting its thumb on the scale for one candidate as opposed to another, let alone talking in private about minorities in this demeaning way, this would be on every network. NPR would never stop talking about it. The New York Times would be on the front page every single day. So clearly, we have a serious problem in this country in that this so-called independent sector, the media, is actually doing unpaid work for one of the political parties. It's a kind of national scandal, to be honest.
If Michael Moore had a movie coming out called Trump's America, you think they'd be giving him time?
They would be giving him all the time in the world. Now, to raise a more delicate point, the Democratic Party would also line up completely behind him. You would think that with our movie, the RNC, the super PACs, our side would be rallying completely behind me. That's not the case. Now, Trump did tweet out, hey guys, go see D'Souza's Hillary's America. But apart from that, the RNC, we've not heard a word from them. The super PACs, we haven't heard. Now, those guys have resources. They could take this movie. They could open up the theaters and get black churches to bring people to the movie. They can bring Latinos to the movie. They don't do this kind of stuff because they're encrusted by consultants who tell them what to do. This movie could help them if only they let it.
Why don't you think they are?
I think it's because our party is very messed up. It's messed up at the core. Part of the success of Trump and the Trump phenomenon is a legitimate backlash from rank-and-file Republicans who know that the corruption extends to our team, that our team itself is not fighting in the way it ought to. And even though I've made this movie at the expense of our investors. We've done messaging. It's a unique type of messaging. The RNC can't do this kind of messaging. They don't even know how to. And we're sort of delivering it out there. So it's almost like a weapon. It's available. We're putting it in your hand. All we're asking you to do is use it, and you won't. Or at least you won't to date.
All right, when we come back, we're going to be talking more about Hillary's America. Don't go away.
When a Secretary of State illegally stores her emails on a private server, deletes 33,000 of them so the authorities can't see her crime, puts our country at risk, lies about it in every different form, and faces no consequence, I know that corruption has reached a level like never, ever before in our country. Her single greatest accomplishment may be committing such egregious crime and getting away with it, especially when others who have done far less have paid so dearly.
Picking up our conversation here with Dinesh D'Souza. You know, during the break, I'm thinking about how angry I am at what you just told me about the RNC. You know, I'm on vacation this week. I live 3 hours from this studio. I came in to do this with you for one reason, and that was because Hillary Clinton cannot be the next president, and we've got to take every resource that's out there and get it out there. I cannot for the life of me understand what has happened to the Republican Party. Who is to blame for this? Is this Paul Ryan? Is this the Koch brothers? Who is the person to point at?
Well, I'm not sure about that, but let me say 4 years ago, we took the Obama movie and we had it independently tested with independent voters. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that independent voters went nuts over it, especially women and Latinos. Why? Because much of that movie was shot in the third world. And so all these Latinos were like, that's the world I know. And the fact that I'm an immigrant, I'm brown skinned, I'm non-white, I'm speaking from my experience. I mean, this resonated with these people. And so we went to Romney, we went to the super PACs, and we were like, look, we've got a movie. It's now coming out in DVD. Why don't you take DVDs and just drop them in the mailboxes of swing voters? You have their names and addresses. It'll cost pennies on the dollar. No, we're not interested. We figured it out. And then they would give you all kinds of nonsense like, people don't like to watch movies anymore. Totally untrue. Or nobody changes their mind by watching a 90-minute movies anymore. Make 90-second videos. One guy says, why don't you take the message of 2016 and make a 90-second video out of it? And I go, look, I'm a guy from India. You want me to convince the American people that Obama is an anti-colonialist? They don't even know what that is in 90 seconds. Are you out of your mind? I mean, I make 90-second videos. They're called trailers. So we know what we're doing. We reach a lot of young people. We reach a lot of people the Republican Party can't reach. But the Romney people were surrounded with these know-it-all, name tag-wearing consultants collecting money from the campaign, getting rich off of this. Politics is a business for them. They don't want to hear it. And so we went our own way. So here we are again 4 years later. I'm not saying the situation will be the same. Mm-hmm. But it is the case that Republicans are the stupid party. And the stupid party... But the stupid party has to figure out a way to beat the evil party. That's where we are in this election. And our resources are so much smaller. They have to be deployed with so much more care. This is a winnable election for Trump. It's a winnable election for Republicans. But we have to fight smart.
What does Hillary's America look like if she is elected president?
Well, Hillary is the Clintons are sort of Bonnie and Clyde. And they're running a racket. And they've been running a racket since the Arkansas days. They couldn't believe it when they got to the White House. Clinton got there almost by fluke. Mm-hmm. And they began figuring out ways to make money in politics. I mean, think about this. These two have never really worked in the private sector at all. They've been on government salary all their lives, and yet they've gone from zero to $300 million. How do you do that? I mean, is there even a legitimate way to imagine that happening? No. So what these guys do is they cash in on public policy. Now, people do this all the time again in India. They do it in Venezuela. You go into government to loot the treasury and make money. But that is not the American way. In America, we've had rich presidents. FDR was rich. JFK was rich. But they were rich before. They didn't become rich off of the White House.
Right.
The Clintons do. So they rent out the Lincoln bedroom for cash. They take stuff off the walls and loot the White House before they leave. They're forced to return a bunch of it later. And they're selling pardons to big-time racketeers, tax avoiders and criminals. And so I can only shudder to think what Hillary's America will look like if you put these people with the ultimate levers of power.
We learned that from the musical Evita.
And the money kept rolling in from every side.
Whether you can give $5 or $500 today.
When the money keeps rolling in, you don't ask how. Think of all the people guaranteed a good time now. Never scold the hungry to open up the doors. Never been a family, the foundation never been right.
Evita's foundation funneled millions of dollars given for the poor into her own bank accounts. Certainly the Clintons wouldn't steal from the poorest of the poor. Author Peter Schweitzer thinks otherwise. He's been investigating the Clinton Foundation.
It seems, Peter, that there has been an element of gangsterism in politics, but the Clintons, they have taken gangsterism to a completely new level.
They've taken it to a global level, and they put it on steroids in a massive way that's unprecedented in American history.
You know, if you take a look at the issues that we're facing, I mean, the ones that are really, really bad, you've got immigration, you've got Obamacare, you've got ISIS, and you've, aside from the debt, you've got the economy. Of those things right there, let's even put the debt. Let's say those five things are really the big drivers of impacting this country long term. If there was one of those things that you thought that Hillary was going to definitely take into the wrong direction, to almost to the point of where it was just insanely irreversible, which one?
Well, I think we have to step back and look at Hillary's attitude towards all of them, because it's the same. Mm-hmm. Different than Obama. With Obama, he will look at all those positions and he will take the wrong position on just about all of them. But the wrong position for Obama is sincerely held. He literally thinks that the best way to, for example, deal with radical Islam is to coddle it, is to appease it. He thinks that in his own world. He thinks it's good for America to shrink our defense spending and make us weaker. He thinks that's good. He doesn't understand why we're using so much energy. If he could figure out a way for Americans to use less healthcare, less energy, he thinks that's good. Now with Hillary, the way to think about Hillary and Bill is that these are two people who are robbing Fort Knox. Now, imagine people running in, giving them memos. Hey, Benghazi. Hey, our security personnel are threatened. Hey, we got to do something about Obamacare. Their point is, leave me alone. Don't bother me. I'm robbing Fort Knox, can't you see? So in other words, for Hillary, all of the rest of this is like a distraction. That explains her impatient, irritated response to Benghazi. When she says, what difference does it make? What she means is, what difference does it make to us Clintons when we're robbing Fort Knox?
Mm-hmm. So if the person who's watching your film, if they come out of that film and they are concerned, What is going to be the driver of that concern? Is it the Clintons' corruption? Is it the fact that they're going to continue what would otherwise be a third term of Obama's presidency? What is it?
I think the person seeing our film will be shocked to realize that a lot of this has been going on for a long time. Mm-hmm. Andrew Jackson was the founder of the Democratic Party. And Andrew Jackson is known as this kind of intrepid Indian fighter. And whether you agree or disagree, kind of tough guy, vacating the Indians off their land, driving them west. Now, little known about Andrew Jackson is how much he profited personally off of all this. When he would fight the Indians, before the fight even occurred, he'd send his own private surveyors to go into the Indian land and assess its value. Then he would call on his buddies who were investors, and they would bid on that land even before it came up for sale, because he knew it was coming up for sale, because he was the one pushing the Indians off their land. And so Andrew Jackson went from, to use Hillary's phrase, dead broke, to being one of the richest men in the United States. He went and bought a huge plantation in Tennessee, hundreds of slaves. So the roots of the Clinton Foundation can be found in the land-stealing policies of Andrew Jackson. So I think someone watching our movie, this isn't just Hillary bashing. This is setting a whole context, a story of American politics and of this Democratic Party, which has been stealing people's labor, slavery, mm-hmm. stealing their women in all the bad stuff that went on the plantation, segregating and oppressing people, running financial scams for a long time. The Democrats invented the urban big city boss, Tammany Hall, the daily racket in Chicago. The difference with the Clintons is they've taken all this stuff and they've taken it not only national, they've taken it global.
When you have the movie out and you also have the book out, right?
Right. The book has chapter and verse because people will see the movie and the movie just almost coolly makes these remarkable claims. At one point I say in the film, in 1860, the year of the Civil War, no Republican owned a slave. All the slaves in the entire country were owned by Democrats. And people go, what? What? What's the basis for that? Well, that's the beauty of a book, because there's nothing in the movie that isn't substantiated, footnotes, chapter and verse, and a whole bunch of other stuff that's not in the movie that's in the book, Hillary's America.
All right.
Donald Trump painted a picture, a negative, dark, divisive picture of a country in decline.
They thought my speech was very dark. They all used that same term, very dark. And I said, actually, it wasn't dark. It was very optimistic.
Why did Hillary get rid of her middle name?
Huh?
Hillary?
No, but why did she get rid of it?
Hillary Rotten Clinton. Rotten Clinton. Hillary Rotten Clinton, right? Maybe that's why. It's too close. No, it's too close.
Now, the Klan had a revival in the early part of the 20th century. Why was that?
Another fan of the KKK was none other than President Woodrow Wilson.
Tell me about the screening of the film called The Birth of a Nation by D.W. Griffith.
It was unfortunate for our country that the first movie ever screened in the White House was a racist movie by a racist Democratic president. The film led to the rebirth of the Klan in America. The film quoted Wilson. It denounced the Reconstruction era when blacks briefly held office. It depicted blacks played by whites in blackface as ugly, vulgar, and uncivilized predators who liked nothing better than raping white women.
You're a Trump supporter, yes?
Yes.
Okay. How would you describe in short form the difference between Trump's America and Hillary's America?
Well, I think with Trump, he's clearly a patriot. He loves his country. Number two, he's unapologetic about wealth he's created. I wouldn't begrudge the Clintons if they actually created wealth, if they started a business, if they invented the iPhone. But they have acquired wealth without creating it, you might say. The other thing about Trump is he's politically incorrect. He's bold. He's brave. I like that. There are question marks about Trump. I mean, when you get someone who's an outsider, the advantage is they're an outsider. The downside is there are a lot of things you don't know about what they do. So to me, you have Trump. The Trump door has some question marks on that door. But the Hillary door is marked a known crook. Now, we've had crooks in American politics before. We find out they're crooks, we throw them out. But never before that I can think of have Americans known in advance that somebody is a crook and said, oh, that's okay, we're going to go with her anyway. That's what the Democratic Party has decided to do. And I shudder to think if America will do the same.
But that says something. I mean, most people, Dinesh, they don't care about what she did in Benghazi. They don't care about her emails. I try having these conversations with people sometimes, and it goes right over their head. They don't care one iota. Why? How did America get like this?
Well, the ordinary American is not paying attention to politics. And so part of the reason that they don't care, and I discovered this in making movies, you have to make that extra step of showing why this matters, not simply what she did. Let's say she deleted a bunch of emails. So what? But if you show that the reason she deleted emails is that Hillary was conducting a whole private foreign policy of her own, actually making money in these trouble spots in the world, robbing people in desperately poor places like Haiti, where aid money is supposed to go to poor Haitians, and the Clintons are conveniently interposed between that aid money and the Haitians. The Haitians don't get it, the Clintons do. Then people go, that's pretty dirty. I mean, it's one thing to rob rich people. It's another thing to rob poor people.
Absolutely. And so then that comes back to the media. You know, I understand the media doesn't want Trump in there because he represents maybe what some people would say was far right, shutting down the borders and deporting illegal aliens and, you know, the temporary ban on Muslims and all these different things. But they have a woman who, as you just said, takes money away from the poor people of Haiti. Why aren't the executives and the anchors and everybody involved in these big medias, whether it's The Times or ABC, NBC, whatever it is, why aren't they upset about that? Why aren't they pushing for somebody else versus her?
I think it's because they understand that the Democratic Party racket is their racket as well. And here's what I mean. There's a silent war that's going on in this country between two groups of people. On the one hand, the entrepreneurs and the wealth creators. And that's not just someone who starts a business. It's all the guys who work for it, too. But they're creating wealth. Now, if you think about the guys in academia, the guys in the media, the community organizers of America, the people who are in Hollywood, they don't actually make stuff. Mm. They make words. They are entrepreneurs of ideas. And what they believe is that these entrepreneurs who make products don't have the right to run this country. We do. We are the planners. We are the organizers. We should be organizing the wealth of society, and we should be at the top of the totem pole. So even though Hillary's a crook, their view is she's our crook, because she will transfer power away from the entrepreneurial class toward the governmental class, toward the class of people who deal not in things but in words. And that's going to make academics more powerful, journalists more powerful, Hollywood guys more powerful. So they see themselves as in the same bed as Hillary, and they're willing to overlook her peccadilloes because she's doing their work.
Strip away Hillary for a second. Strip away Trump for a second. Just take the incredible intelligence that you have and everything that you do, and you've traveled the country. I know you go around giving speeches, so you're seeing all the different places of America. What do you think America needs in order to be able to recover from where we are right now, 8 years after Obama?
I think America needs to have just a simple appreciation of the great marvel of technological capitalism. In other words, remove technological capitalism and the whole world would be eking and scratching a living out of the ground. In most places, like India, poverty is taken for granted. And people say, isn't it terrible that these people are suffering? But the ordinary Indian goes, well, they've been suffering for thousands of years. There's nothing different. It's really hard to scratch a living out of the ground. It's almost biblical. But in America, It's the immigrant coming from the outside like me, and I see, wow, look at the ordinary guy and what a great life he has. Even the guy who's not that smart, who's not that hardworking, even that guy has two cars in his garage. Even that guy has no trouble worrying about his next meal. Even that guy knows that he's going to have a roof over its head when it's raining. Now, what did that? That's not due to government programs. That's not due to IMF loans. The UN didn't do that. Technological capitalism did that. And all kinds of people who came up with the smallest of improvements and inventions. Think of the guy who invented roll-on luggage. Before he thought of that, and you or I could have thought of that, but we didn't, mm-hmm. everyone had to pick up heavy suitcases and lug them around. That guy has made our lives better in very marked, noticeable ways. He's probably done wonders for people's backs just by not having people carry heavy loads. Now, so my point is technological capitalism produces this kind of abundance. A small number, 70% of Americans used to work on farms. Now a very small number of people working in farming can feed not only all of America, can virtually feed the whole world. Mm. Technological capitalism. So I think if we had an appreciation for that and an understanding that people should by and large keep the fruits of their own labor. Not to say we shouldn't have taxes, but there's no reason to have progressive taxation. We need proportional taxation. And the good thing about proportional taxation, look, people vote on what that tax level should be. So you can say, all right, I think taxes should be higher. But if you think taxes should be higher, you're going to be raising your own taxes as well. You don't get to say, I think taxes should be higher on that guy and lower on me. That's the kind of corruption that has now woven its way into our democratic process.
What about from a leadership perspective? Because I know your whole start in politics was with the Reagan administration. So you understand who Reagan was, the power of leadership that he exuded. What sort of leader do we need? And do you think Trump fits that mold?
Well, I think, as I say, Trump would be an outsider. Now, we haven't had an outsider since Eisenhower, a guy who is not elected, not a governor, not a senator, coming, if you will, from non-elected office. That hasn't happened since World War II. And Eisenhower was the supreme commander of World War II. So I think with Trump, it remains to be seen. Now, Trump was a young Reaganite in the 80s, and maybe he's taken a lesson or two from Reagan. I don't just miss Reagan. I also miss the intellectual luminaries I looked up to. William F. Buckley, Friedrich Hayek, Irving Kristol, Solzhenitsyn. Where are people of that caliber today? Or statesmen in politics? Howard Baker, the head of the Senate. James Baker,
why
Secretary
do you think it's
of
all,
State.
Why is it all missing?
George Shultz. For some reason, it seems like we've seen a diminution, a kind of shrinkage of stature. And now we have these puny guys, even on our side, who couldn't hold a candle to those guys.
What drove that? What drove that change?
I'm not entirely sure, because the change has been across the board, a kind of coarsening of standards. The country has changed. Look, I was a think tank guy, a speaker, a writer of books. One reason I've gone into movies, I love movies, but the reason I went into movies was basically to reach more people. I realized that people are more emotional in our culture today. You have to tell a story. You can't just make a legal or an argument. And so the movie allows you to tap chords not only of the head but of the heart that a book won't tap.
We only got 30 seconds. If you had to say it in 30 seconds, why somebody needs to go see Hillary's America?
It just tells you a new story about America that will terrify you, but will also inspire you. It'll show you what you can do. So Hillary's America, themovie.com, that's our website. You can plug in your zip code. You can see where the movie's playing near you. So see the movie, get the book.
Last question. Do you think America will ever be able to go back to the way it was before Obama, Trump or Hillary?
I think it's possible. I think this is we're in a difficult time. We have to get through it. But America's a great country. I'm not an apocalyptic guy who goes, you know, if Hillary wins, the country's done. We're not done. We're a long way from being done. And I think the can-do inventiveness of the American spirit, the fairness of the American people, their generosity, that remains.
All right. Thank you, Dinesh D'Souza. Good luck.
My pleasure.
Go see the film.
What if the goal of the Democratic Party is to steal the most valuable thing the world has ever produced?
Them, if only they'd let it.
Why don't you think they are?
I think it's because our party is very messed up. It's messed up at the core. Part of the success of Trump and the Trump phenomenon is a legitimate backlash from rank and file Republicans who know that the corruption extends to our team, that our team itself is not fighting in the way it ought to. And even though I've made this movie at the expense of our investors. We've done messaging. It's a unique type of messaging. The RNC can't do this kind of messaging. They don't even know how to. And we're sort of delivering it out there. So you know, it's almost like a weapon. It's available. We're putting it in your hand. All we're asking you to do is use it, and you won't. Or at least you won't to date.
All right, when we come back, we're going to be talking more about Hillary's America. Don't go away.
When a Secretary of State illegally stores her emails on a private server, deletes 33,000 of them so the authorities can't see her crime, puts our country at risk, lies about it in every different form, and faces no consequence, I know that corruption has reached a level like never ever before in our country. Her single greatest accomplishment may be committing such egregious crime and getting away with it, especially when others who have done far less have paid so dearly.
Picking up our conversation here with Dinesh D'Souza. You know, during the break, I'm thinking about how angry I am at what you just told me about the RNC. You know, I'm on vacation this week. I live 3 hours from this studio. I came in to do this with you for one reason, and that was because Hillary Clinton cannot be the next president, and we've got to take every resource that's out there and get it out there. I cannot for the life of me understand what has happened to the Republican Party. Who is to blame for this? Is this Paul Ryan? Is this the Koch brothers? Who is the person to point at?
Well, I'm not sure about that, but let me say 4 years ago, we took the Obama movie and we had it independently tested with independent voters. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that independent voters went nuts over it, especially women and Latinos. Why? Because much of that movie was shot in the third world. And so all these Latinos were like, that's the world I know. And the fact that I'm an immigrant, I'm brown-skinned, I'm non-white, I'm speaking from my experience. I mean, this resonated with these people. And so we went to Romney, we went to the Super PACs, and we were like, look, we've got a movie. It's now coming out in DVD. Why don't you take DVDs and just drop them in the mailboxes of swing voters? You have their names and addresses. It'll cost pennies on the dollar. No, we're not interested. We figured it out. And then they would give you all kinds of nonsense like, people don't like to watch movies anymore. Totally untrue. Or nobody changes their mind by watching 90-minute movies anymore. Make 90-second videos. One guy says, why don't you take the message of 2016 and make a 90-second video out of it? And I go, look, I'm a guy from India. You want me to convince the American people that Obama is an anti-colonialist? They don't even know what that is in 90 seconds. Are you out of your mind? I mean, I make 90-second videos. They're called trailers. So we know what we're doing. We reach a lot of young people. We reach a lot of people the Republican Party can't reach, but the Romney people were surrounded with these know-it-all, name tag wearing consultants collecting money from the campaign, getting rich off of this. Politics as a business for them. They don't want to hear it, and so we went our own way. So here we are again 4 years later. I'm not saying the situation will be the same, mm-hmm. but it is the case that Republicans are the stupid party, and the stupid party but the stupid party has to figure out a way to beat the evil party. That's where we are in this election, and our resources are so much smaller. They have to be deployed with so much more care. This is a winnable election for Trump. It's a winnable election for Republicans, but we have to fight smart.
What does Hillary's America look like if she is elected president?
Well, Hillary is the Clintons are sort of Bonnie and Clyde, and they're running a racket, and they've been running a racket since the Arkansas days. They couldn't believe it when they got to the White House. Clinton got there almost by fluke. Mm-hmm. And they began figuring out ways to make money in politics. I mean, think about this. These two have never really worked in the private sector at all. They've been on government salary all their lives, and yet they've gone from zero to $300 million How do you do that? I mean, is there even a legitimate way to imagine that happening? No. So what these guys do is they cash in on public policy. Now, people do this all the time again in India. They do it in Venezuela. You go into government to loot the treasury and make money. But that is not the American way. In America, we've had rich presidents. FDR was rich. JFK was rich. Well, but they were rich before. They didn't become rich off of the White House.
Right.
The Clintons do. So they rent out the Lincoln bedroom for cash. They take stuff off the walls and loot the White House before they leave. They're forced to return a bunch of it later. And they're selling pardons to big-time racketeers, tax avoiders, and criminals. And so I can only shudder to think what Hillary's America will look like if you put these people with the ultimate levers of power.
We learn that from the musical Evita.
And the money kept rolling in from every side.
Whether you can give $5 or $500 today.
When the money keeps rolling in, you don't ask how. Think of all the people guaranteed a good time now. Never ask all the hungry to open up the doors. Never been a family, the foundation never broke.
Evita's foundation funneled millions of dollars given for the poor into her own bank accounts. Certainly the Clintons wouldn't steal from the poorest of the poor. Author Peter Schweitzer thinks otherwise. He's been investigating the Clinton Foundation.
It seems, Peter, that there has been an element of gangsterism in politics, but the Clintons, they have taken gangsterism to a completely new level.
They've taken it to a global level. And they put it on steroids in a massive way that's unprecedented in American history.
You know, if you take a look at the issues that we're facing, I mean, the ones that are really, really bad. You've got immigration. You've got Obamacare.
The gangsters sometimes get knocked off. So he thinks, I'll take these ideas to politics. In politics, I can pull off extortion a la Jesse Jackson, but I won't get knocked off. And it's kind of amazing to think that Obama and Hillary are both influenced by this guy, who's obviously a thief and a bit of a mobster.
Let's go back to Obama for a second. When you watch him absolutely, completely ignore for so long the rule of law, and then you see now what's going on with the cops and how it is that Black Lives Matter is not only emerging, but he fuels them. What inside him is driving that? Because the rest of us, we look at this and say, why are you supporting these people? And he continues to do so.
Now, Obama is different than Hillary, I believe, even though they have Alinsky in common. And Alinsky was sort of a mentor to both. Now, Obama didn't know Alinsky personally, but he studied with the Alinskyites. Hillary knew Alinsky in person. But the difference between Obama and Hillary is that Obama is fueled, I think, ultimately by ideological hatred. For Obama, he looks at America and he goes, you know, how dare they? Not how dare we, but how dare they? Meaning, here's America, they have 5% of the world's population, but Americans enjoy 20% of the world's resources. America has 5% of the world's oil, but we use 25% of the world's oil. So he's thinking, this is unjust. These Americans are ripping off the rest of the world. It's my job, the great Obama, to set the ship of the world right side up. And that means diminishing America's power so that the other countries, Brazil, China, Russia, India, can come up. So I think Obama sees this as his, you may say, perverted destiny. Now, with Hillary, it's not about ideology. It's about the Clintons. It's Bonnie and Clyde. It's a racket. And these two have been running this tag team show since the Arkansas days. It's all about them. They're sort of brokers of public policy, which is to say that they figure out how to do public policy and keep 10%. And they do this with domestic policy. They do it with foreign policy. And so Hillary's America, I think, is going to be a more gangsterish place.
Before we get there, because we're going to talk about that in the next segment. If Hillary wins, and we have about a minute, what sort of role, if any, do you think Obama will play in her presidency?
I think Obama, there's the only place for him to go from here is to become, in a sense, what he would see as the conscience of the world. Now, this is all pure grand illusion and posturing. He's actually a very petty man. He's a narcissistic guy. His favorite position is to look in the mirror. He's not the conscience of anything in reality. But he's a lot like his dad. His father had the same warped delusions. His father thought he was a super important guy. The future of Kenya depended on him. Complete nonsense. But Obama's the same. He lives in his own world. And I think he wants to be, if you will, even higher than the President of the United States. You may call him sort of the grand poobah of the universe, looking down on the rest of us and telling us what to do. He'd love to play that role. I think he will actually lapse into largely into irrelevance. But that's what he'd like.
All right, when we come back, we're going to be focusing in on the new movie and Hillary Rodham Clinton. What will Hillary's America look like?
While Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State, the Clintons took hundreds of millions of dollars from foreign entities.
Shame on you! Shame on you!
She looked very menacing. I was really frightened.
I didn't see any reason to keep them.
The fact is, we have four dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
It is my judgment.
Dinesh D'Souza was sentenced on Tuesday to spend 8 months in a confinement center.
It all began when the Obama administration tried to shut me up.
You know, gangs are all about stealing, man.
What did I learn? All crime is about stealing. The big criminals are still at large.
Didn't see any reason to keep them.
The system doesn't go after them. Because they run the system. It's time to go behind the curtain and discover the soul of the Democratic Party.
Explain what we just saw in that clip.
Well, in that clip, you see me in the confinement center. This is a federal confinement center under the supervision of the Bureau of Prisons. And this was for my heinous offense of giving $20,000 of my own money to a college friend of mine who was running for the U.S. Senate in New York. I shouldn't have done it, but I did it without any corrupt motive, just to help a friend. And there's no one in all of American history who has been prosecuted, let alone locked up, for doing what I did. Typically, a campaign finance law is to prevent corruption. So you're trying to buy office, you're trying to ultimately get some legislation passed, and so the money changes hands for that purpose. Nothing like that was involved here. So I believe I was persecuted, selectively prosecuted by Obama in retaliation for making this movie 2016. And the reason I know that Obama was upset by the movie is he began to rage against me on a website, barackobama.com. And so I think I was stupid in committing this technical violation of the law, which gave them a pretext to go after me.
Dennis Michael Lynch is also a conservative documentary filmmaker, the producer of They Come to America, and he spent time with Dinesh as their careers have crossed. Dennis, it's good to see you, and I know you believe that he may be a victim of political targeting here. Why?
Absolutely. Film is the most powerful medium we have. You have a captive audience for 2 hours. So when you make a film that hits the president between the eyes and could shift an election, you become a target because you're not only a talking, but you're a visual, and you put that together. So I know I've lived through this with immigration reform. I mean, I help impact which way that's going to go by showing films that give you what you need to see. You do that, you become dangerous to the other side. When you're dangerous to the other side, you walk around with a target on your back, and that's what you're seeing.
I tried to turn the lemon into lemonade by learning from this experience and then putting it into this film, the new film, and basically using it to widen my horizons and how I understand politics, not merely as a function of...
Tonight, he came up with Obama's America, and now he has Hillary's America. For the next hour, I will be with Dinesh D'Souza. So get ready, because it's all unfiltered. Hello, I'm Dennis Michael Lynch, and I thank you for joining me this evening. There will be no DML report tonight because I have Dinesh D'Souza here with me for the next hour. We are going to be talking about his new film called Hillary's America. We all know how successful Obama's America was. Dinesh D'Souza tonight is going to tell us about what we are in for.
if Hillary Clinton is elected president. That being said, Dinesh, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
I want to do this a little backward. I want to talk about Obama's America. And the reason being is because I think it's critically important for people to realize how much you are in the know. I just watched, by chance, your film again, Obama's America, not more than a couple weeks ago. And watching it for the second time, it's astonishing how right your predictions have come out to be.
For a long time, I sat between the two graves and wept. The pain I felt was my father's pain. My questions were my brother's questions. Their struggle, my birthright.
Obama has a dream from his father, that the sins of colonialism be set right and America be downsized.
It's been a long time coming. But tonight, because of what we did on this day, in this election, at this defining moment, change has come to America.
America has a dream from our founding fathers that together we must perfect liberty and America must grow so liberty grows. Which dream will we carry into 2016?
So when you look back at what you saw in 2012 when you made that film, and you look today at the way America is, of all the predictions you made, which ones are most troubling to you that have come true?
Well, in that movie, we tried to get to the soul of Obama, to kind of get to how he thinks about the world. And I identified his ideology as anti-colonial, as something derived from his father. The notion that America is a force for oppression in the world. This is what Obama believes. And as consequently, he views his job as one of shrinking America's power and influence. Now, out of that came several predictions. One was that Obama would continue to be a big spender, in a sense eroding our national treasure, doubling the national debt. That has happened. Number two, Obama would try to colonize industries of the private sector, bring them under the rod of government control. We've seen that happen in healthcare, in finance, with banks, insurance companies. Obama will undermine our allies and help our enemies. This is a wild prediction because you elect a president to protect America's interests. But you can just look clinically around the world. Our allies, Mubarak in Egypt, he's gone. Gaddafi wasn't an ally, but he was working with us since the Iraq war. He's gone. Our enemies, Assad in Syria, he's fully in power. The mullahs in Iran, they're stronger than ever. So it is simply empirically verifiable that Obama has actually achieved this result. ISIS did not really exist. Obama and Hillary come in, now we have ISIS. And we also said that the Muslims will begin to start creating this transnational, I called it the United States of Islam.
Yeah.
And if you look at ISIS, the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, it's very clear that they are not only consolidating, but bringing the battle to us here. So I think Obama, in a way, this demented man can be proud of his legacy. He said he would transform America, and he has. And he has transformed it in the direction that we said he would. So I feel very, I don't know if I'm proud to be vindicated because these are bad things to happen to America. I would rather have been proven wrong.
Right.
But I'm glad to see I made a film that called Obama right.
Well, one of the things that you said in the film, which I talk about here on the show all the time, is the fact that although he never met his father, he's influenced by his father, right? So when you describe, when you take a look at that, do you see any sort of person in Hillary's life that has that same sort of influence?
In Hillary's life, I think it would have to be Alinsky. Now, an interesting thing about Alinsky is that conservatives tend to focus on the radical Alinsky. Alinsky wrote a book, Rules for Radicals. He's got all these recipes and so on for political activism. And that's one side of Alinsky, and it's a legitimate side. Ben Carson was alluding to that side when he talked about Alinsky dedicating his book to Lucifer. But in the movie, the new movie, Hillary's America, we focus on another side of Alinsky, which Alinsky himself talked about in the last year of his life. Alinsky talked about the fact that he was basically a thief and a gangster, kind of a mafia guy. Alinsky was a petty thief on the streets of Chicago. Then he got to the University of Chicago and he developed a kind of a, almost call it a thievery scheme, to eat free in the cafeteria. Now, you know, I can see some poor slum kid figuring out a way to eat free, but Alinsky would have seminars on the topic. He'd put up signs, come and learn the Alinsky method for eating free without paying. And so you can almost see the beginning of community organizing occurring right there. This guy Alinsky is organizing ways to rip off the university. Later he gets in with the Al Capone gang. He admires their extortionist rackets. He doesn't like the fact that ideas, two groups debating each other, but also as a racket, a kind of criminal racket. And of course, being with the hoodlums and sleeping in bunk beds with them, I learned something about gangs, about criminal rackets, about extortion, how you get money out of people. Excellent preparation for studying the Democratic Party.
Well, let me ask you, if I was going to ask you this later on, but I'll ask you now because you're bringing it up. If, God forbid, she wins, are you afraid that you're going to have to, I'm sure you haven't done anything else of the sorts, but I mean, are you afraid that she'll try to retaliate against you as well?
You know, I have to watch my back, and I realize that I'm kind of on the front line. I think in some ways that's a safe place to be, because think about it. If the narrator, author, and creator of Hillary's America were to disappear, who would be the main suspect?
I don't even mean to that end. I just mean to the end of, like, she will just try to make your life miserable.
Yeah, I expect, you know, that is fully in character for the Clintons, because they operate kind of in the Al Capone mode. They would like to be, I think if they had their way, unlike Obama, their goal is to be the mob boss of America. So if you think about Al Capone, what did Al Capone want in Chicago? He wanted the city to run at his behest and command. He wanted to loot the treasury. He wanted to give contracts to his buddies. He wanted his opponents and critics to be moved off stage, snuffed out, pushed away. And he wanted to walk into the Chicago Cubs stadium and have the whole crowd go, Big Al, Big Al, Big Al. This is basically the cult-like ambition of the Clintons. Now, Bill's ambitions are more circumscribed, because I think if Bill has big meals, everyone thinks he's the greatest, he has women lined up the door, he's happy. With Hillary, it's a more tyrannical impulse. She wants to run everything. She wants to control everything. She'd love to run your life and my life. And so she's a scarier character, to my way of thinking, than Bill.
So then I guess the answer is that you expect that she will give you a hard time if she does get elected president.
I think she will try to, happily. We don't live today in India or Venezuela. My wife's from Venezuela. I think if we live in those countries, they're run by gangs. And I can't make this kind of a movie over there, because they'll just send gangs to the house to beat you up and break all your furniture and take your big screen TV. We still live in America. We still have fundamental rights. We still have separation of powers, checks and balances. Hopefully we'll maintain an independent judiciary. So there are protections here that I still count on.
Look, you know, when you take a look at the mainstream media, actually, if you even do the numbers, you take Fox News, you take Newsmax, you put us together, we don't even touch a fraction of what ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN, MSNBC, that they all reach. So not the numbers of people who have to see a film like yours or have to hear the message that you give on something like this, we need to get it out there more. So what I want you to do is I want you to explain how this movie, if put in front of an independent, how this movie will influence them. Because I think ultimately, one thing I've always done, it's been very helpful with when I was doing my DVD program, is I would give out extras and I'd say, listen, you gotta put this in front of a Democrat so they understand how bad immigration is. When they see it, they'll think differently. How does the person at home right now who's watching this, who's a conservative, what in that film is it that you say, you gotta say this to your friends and get them to the theater?
The film is very explosive because it challenges the central core basis of the whole Democratic Party. In this way, it's a much more destructive and it's a much more subversive film than Obama's America. Because Obama's America was about one man. And that man was an outsider. And even for 8 years, his relationship with the Democratic Party somewhat tenuous. Hillary comes right out of the progressive movement and right out of the Democratic Party. And the Democratic Party has a moral claim to rule. And that is, we Democrats, they say, have always been the party of the little man, the ordinary guy. We have been the party of women's suffrage and fighting for women's rights. We freed the slaves and fought for civil rights. We're the party of blacks. We fought for immigration. We're the party of Latinos. Now, we in the film expose that all of this is a big, fat lie. The Democrats have been the party that has been the deadly enemy of the ordinary guy. They have been the enslavers and segregators of blacks and lynchers of blacks. They have been the party that has blocked immigration and tormented the Hispanics and the Latinos. They fought women's suffrage tooth and nail for 25 years. They lost in Congress, and they fought it in the states where they lost again. So this is the actual history of the Democratic Party. Fast forward to this recent email scandal, and you see how the Democrats privately talk about blacks. When they talk about Hispanics, it's the Taco Bell gang, because they think of Hispanics as serving you in Taco Bell. They insult blacks, they insult homosexuals, they make fun of Bernie Sanders' religion. So they put up a big front out here, and in Philadelphia, all these squid-like cloud of rhetoric, but the reality of the party is somewhat different. So if independents, if blacks, if Latinos saw this movie, the effect would be discombobulating, because it would show that all the stuff that they've been spoon-fed by the media and academia is wrong. And so I would love to figure out a way to get this movie in front of them. It's not easy, because like you say, typically you preach to the converted, and it's important to preach to the converted, but if we could get a way to get it to the outsider, that would be fantastic.
Has ABC, NBC, CBS, any of those major networks had you on yet?
No, those guys are covering for Hillary, and they're absolutely, I mean, just think about it. If it turned out that the Republican Party was fixing its primary election, putting its thumb on the scale for one candidate as opposed to another, let alone talking in private about minorities in this demeaning way, this would be on every network. NPR would never stop talking about it. The New York Times would be on the front page every single day. So clearly we have a serious problem in this country in that this so-called independent sector, the media, is actually doing unpaid work for one of the political parties. It's a kind of national scandal, to be honest.
If Michael Moore had a movie coming out called Trump's America, you think they'd be giving him time?
They would be giving him all the time in the world. Now, to raise a more delicate point, the Democratic Party would also line up completely behind him. You would think that with our movie, the RNC, the super PACs, our side would be rallying completely behind me. That's not the case. Now, Trump did tweet out, hey guys, go see D'Souza's Hillary's America. But apart from that, the RNC, we've not heard a word from them. The super PACs, we haven't heard. Now, those guys have resources. They could take this movie. They could open up the theaters and get black churches to bring people to the movie. They can bring Latinos to the movie. They don't do this kind of stuff because they're encrusted by consultants who tell them what to do. This movie could help.
You've got ISIS, and aside from the debt, you've got the economy. Of those things right there, let's even put the debt. Let's say those five things are really the big drivers of impacting this country long term. If there was one of those things that you thought that Hillary was going to definitely take into the wrong direction, to almost to the point of where it was just insanely irreversible, which one?
Well, I think we have to step back and look at Hillary's attitude towards all of them, because it's the same. Mm-hmm. Different than Obama. With Obama, he will look at all those positions and he will take the wrong position on just about all of them. But the wrong position for Obama is sincerely held. He literally thinks that the best way to, for example, deal with radical Islam is to coddle it, is to appease it. He thinks that in his own world. He thinks it's good for America to shrink our defense spending and make us weaker. He thinks that's good. He doesn't understand why we're using so much energy. If he could figure out a way for Americans to use less healthcare, less energy, he thinks that's good. Now with Hillary, the way to think about Hillary and Bill is that these are two people who are robbing Fort Knox. Now imagine people running in, giving them memos. Hey, Benghazi, hey, our security personnel are threatened. Hey, we got to do something about Obamacare. Their point is, leave me alone. Don't bother me. I'm robbing Fort Knox, can't you see? So in other words, for Hillary, all of the rest of this is like a distraction. That explains her impatient, irritated response to Benghazi. When she says, what difference does it make? What she means is, what difference does it make to us Clintons when we're robbing Fort Knox?
Mm-hmm. So if the person who's watching your film, if they come out of that film and they are concerned, What is going to be the driver of that concern? Is it the Clinton's corruption? Is it the fact that they're going to continue what would otherwise be a third term of Obama's presidency? What is it?
I think the person seeing our film will be shocked to realize that a lot of this has been going on for a long time. Mm-hmm. Andrew Jackson was the founder of the Democratic Party. And Andrew Jackson is known as this kind of intrepid Indian fighter. And whether you agree or disagree, kind of tough guy, vacating the Indians off their land, driving them west. Now, little known about Andrew Jackson is how much he profited personally off of all this. When he would fight the Indians, before the fight even occurred, he'd send his own private surveyors to go into the Indian land and assess its value. Then he would call on his buddies who were investors, and they would bid on that land even before it came up for sale, because he knew it was coming up for sale, because he was the one pushing the Indians off their land. And so Andrew Jackson went from, to use Hillary's phrase, dead broke, to being one of the richest men in the United States. He went and bought a huge plantation in Tennessee, hundreds of slaves. So the roots of the Clinton Foundation can be found in the land-stealing policies of Andrew Jackson. So I think someone watching our movie, this isn't just Hillary bashing. This is setting a whole context, a story of American politics and of this Democratic Party, which has been stealing people's labor, slavery, mm-hmm. stealing their women in all the bad stuff that went on the plantation, segregating and oppressing people, running financial scams for a long time. The Democrats invented the urban big city boss, Tammany Hall, the daily racket in Chicago. The difference with the Clintons is they've taken all this stuff and they've taken it not only national, they've taken it global.
When you have the movie out and you also have the book out, right?
Right. The book has chapter and verse because people will see the movie and the movie just almost coolly makes these remarkable claims. At one point I say in the film, in 1860, the year of the Civil War, no Republican owned a slave. All the slaves in the entire country were owned by Democrats. And people go, what? What? What's the basis for that? Well, that's the beauty of a book, because there's nothing in the movie that isn't substantiated, footnotes, chapter and verse, and a whole bunch of other stuff that's not in the movie that's in the book, Hillary's America.
All right.
Donald Trump painted a picture, a negative, dark, divisive picture of a country in decline.
They thought my speech was very dark. They all used that same term, very dark. And I said, actually, it wasn't dark. It was very optimistic.
Why did Hillary get rid of her middle name?
Huh?
Hillary? No, but why did she get rid of it? Hillary Rotten Clinton. Rotten Clinton. Hillary Rotten Clinton, right? Maybe that's why. It's too close. No, it's too close.
Now, the Klan had a revival in the early part of the 20th century. Why was that?
Another fan of the KKK was none other than President Woodrow Wilson.
Tell me about the screening of the film called The Birth of a Nation by D.W. Griffith.
It was unfortunate for our country that the first movie ever screened in the White House was a racist movie by a racist Democratic president. The film led to the rebirth of the Klan in America. The film quoted Wilson. It denounced the Reconstruction era when blacks briefly held office. It depicted blacks, played by whites in blackface, as ugly, vulgar, and uncivilized predators who liked nothing better than raping white women.
You're a Trump supporter, yes?
Yes.
Okay. How would you describe, in short form, the difference between Trump's America and Hillary's America?
Well, I think with Trump, he's clearly a patriot. He loves his country. Number two, he's unapologetic about wealth. Wealth he's created. And I wouldn't begrudge the Clintons if they actually created wealth, if they started a business, if they invented the iPhone. But they have acquired wealth without creating it, you might say. The other thing about Trump is he's politically incorrect. He's bold. He's brave. I like that. There are question marks about Trump. I mean, when you get someone who's an outsider, the advantage is they're an outsider. The downside is there are a lot of things you don't know about what they do. So to me, you have Trump. The Trump door has some question marks on that door. But the Hillary door is marked a known crook. Now, we've had crooks in American politics before. We find out they're crooks, we throw them out. But never before that I can think of have Americans known in advance that somebody is a crook and said, oh, that's okay, we're going to go with our...